The Business of Biotech is produced by Life Science Connect and its community of learning, solving, and sourcing resources for biopharma decision makers. If you're working on biologics process development and manufacturing challenges, you need to swing by bioprocessonline.com. If you're trying to stay ahead of the cell or gene therapy curve, visit cellandgene.com. When it's time to map out your clinical course, let clinicalleader.com help. And if optimizing outsourcing decisions is what you're after, check out outsourcepharma.com. We're Life Science Connect, and we're here to help.
The artificial intelligence and machine learning drumbeats are only getting louder in biotech, and that trend will continue for the foreseeable future. When a new tech fires up the hype machine, it's our job as industry observers to suss out what's real, who's actually adopting and applying the technology to affect outcomes in drug discovery, development, and ultimately patient access. When virtually every biotech who's parsing a little data on a computer calls itself AI-powered, doing that sussing is easier said than done. I'm Matt Piller. This is The Business of Biotech. And on today's episode, I'm sitting down with the leader of one company that's decidedly applying sophisticated computational technologies to its biologic development efforts. Flagship Pioneering's Generate Biomedicines, led by ex-Merck CMO of Human Health, Mike Nally, is using machine learning to make big use of big data. And it's raising big money along the way to support the initiative. I sat down with Mike in San Francisco to learn all about it. Let's give it a listen.
You know, we're going to talk about a lot, but yeah. I want to start with you because when I look at your background, it's not, you know, from an early point post academia, not like it wasn't written in the stars. Nope. You're going to be a biotech CEO. You were a financial analyst at Merck.
Yeah.
That came fresh off of your Harvard MBA, which came on the heels of an economics degree.
That's right.
So that was in 2003. And in 2021, you were still at Merck. You were CMO of Human Health.
Yeah.
So there's many questions in there.
Totally.
One of them being like, that's a long run. That's a long run to be at that company. So why did you decide to leave the comforts of a company like Merck, where you surely could have wrote out the entirety of your career?
Well, it's a really great question. You know, I mean, I think, you know, part of my own personal journey was, you know, when I graduated college, I grew up outside of New York City, and I thought the path of salvation was to be an investment banker because that's what all my friends' parents did.
Yeah.
I mean, my father had his own little business, and you know, in many respects, he was the anomaly within the community that I grew up within.
What was his business?
He was in sporting goods.
Oh, really?
So yeah, he was a sporting goods manufacturer. He'd go over to China, manufacture, and then sell to the mass merchants. And you know, it was a great business. But you know, he was an entrepreneur through and through. And but everyone else in the town were bankers. And you know, I went and studied finance, thinking, you know, that's what you did, you know, when you grew up. And I think, you know, as I stepped back, you know, after the first couple of years, I realized I was missing that sense of purpose. I was missing, you know, to what end am I doing all this work? And, you know, at least for me, you know, the feeling of, you know, slaving away, working, you know, 100-hour weeks to make money for rich people was not how I wanted to spend my time. And you know, some of my best friends are investment bankers, so I don't mean any disrespect to the field. But for me personally, I wanted a broader sense of purpose in my work. And I was fortunate during that time to touch on the pharmaceutical industry. And when I went back to business school, I went with a distinct purpose of transitioning careers. Now, I was really lucky when I knew some of the folks at Merck. One of the ladies who was kind of a financial Mozart, who's Merck CFO, the first female CFO of a Fortune 500 company, said, "Mike, if you come to Merck, I'll show you the whole company." Mm. And this is a lady named Judy Lewent. And, you know, Judy basically was true to her word. Every 18 months, I was doing a different assignment. So I started in the company as a financial analyst doing competitive intelligence, worked on the late stage pipeline, did the pre-commercialization work for a diabetes product called Januvia, was put into investor relations during the Vioxx trials, went into business development, Did the Shearing Plough merger. So if you think about, you know, that sort of broad exposure, I'm a voracious learner.
I was going to say, like, you're talking about this and I'm thinking, like, you've got to be wired a little bit differently. You've got to be a sponge, right? I mean, you've got to be a sponge.
Well, I love, you know, I love science. I love, you know, kind of, you know, the learning process. Mm-hmm. There's so much complexity in the end-to-end business model for these large pharmaceutical companies. I mean, if you think about it, it's a miracle that we're able to come up with medicines.
Yeah.
And, you know, these medicines are harder than putting a man on the moon.
Sure.
You know, in the scientific challenge, the manufacturing challenges, the commercial challenges to make sure that, you know, the world has access to these medicines require really dedicated, committed professionals. And, you know, as I went on those different rotations through Merck, yeah, I was just really blessed to see the end-to-end process working with some of the best people in the industry. And, you know, within any organization, when I joined Merck, I thought I was going to be there 2 to 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And
well, now, were you thinking, like, at the time, you talked about seeking, not to get you off track here, but you talk about seeking a more meaningful end, right? Rather than getting rich and making rich people richer. What was the pharmaceutical industry, life sciences? What was that sort of the, at that time, was that like, well, yeah, that's the place, or, you know, why not some other philanthropic endeavor? Yeah. Or,
well, I think, you know, combining a background in business with a, endeavor that basically was, you know, it's set up to improve the health and well-being of the population was something that was really attractive to me. I also loved the global nature of the industry. I loved the challenges that the industry were facing. You know, the industry's been under, you know, kind of seminal challenges for the last 25 years, right? R&D productivity going down. You think about pricing challenges, right? Access challenges. You know, these are things that unfortunately have undermined the reputation of what was once seen as a very noble industry, mm-hmm. and has made it, on par reputationally with tobacco in the lay public. And, you know, the questions we have to answer and solve for as an industry are really, really profound. And as someone who loves complex challenges, as someone who loves these sort of puzzles, trying to figure out how you right the ship so that you can solve some of the world's greatest unmet medical needs. And, you know, when you talk about sense of purpose, I've had the privilege of working on some of the most impactful programs, products that the industry's ever seen.
Mm-hmm.
Keytruda.
Yeah.
Right? Indicated across 30 different tumor types.
Yeah.
You think about the number of lives you can impact.
Right.
You think about Gardasil for the HPV vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the prospect that we can now eliminate cervical cancer from this planet. Some of the HIV medicines, right, where you're offering the prospect ultimately of stopping the transmission dynamics in HIV. These are things that have global impact, and, you know, millions of people are going to live longer, healthier, happier lives. Right. As a result of that work. And that's what's fulfilling what we do, right? And that's why, you know, a year, 2 years, 3 years at Merck became 18. I was constantly learning. I was constantly challenged. I had mentors who believed in me in ways that I didn't believe in myself.
Yeah.
There were jumps that I took in my career that I probably wouldn't have taken without steady encouragement. You know, Judy was one mentor, Ken Frazier, Merck's former CEO, mm-hmm. Was another, who constantly said, Mike, we want you to go to Sweden and run our Swedish business. I had basically been to Sweden for one day in my life, knew nothing about the Swedish healthcare system, and was asked to run that organization. And, you know, those were opportunities for me to actually become much more self-aware as a professional, to learn, to grow personally with my family going to Sweden, but also professionally, but also contribute to a much greater cause. And that's part of what made, you know, the 18 years at Merck so special.
Yeah. It's interesting. The impact, you talk about the impact that you were able to play a part of in Merck. Often when I, and specific examples, Keytruda, Gardasil, I mean, amazing. Often when I talk with big bio turned biotech CEOs, they tell me that maybe ironically, the tipping point for them wanting to jump into biotech, you know, small, nimble, agile, scrappy,
right,
is because they want to feel like they have more of an impact than they did in big bio. So that's sort of an interesting dichotomy. Totally.
Well, I think you have more control in biotech.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the litmus test that I had when I thought about, you know, leaving Merck was wherever I was going to go, I had to believe fundamentally I could have a greater impact on humanity.
Mm-hmm.
And there aren't many organizations in the world that can have a greater impact on humanity than the company like Merck.
Right.
If you think about the history of the company, from the mass production of penicillin in the 50s, all the way through a series of antivirals, vaccines, you know, 7 of the 11 CDC recommended vaccines were invented by Merck, the cardiovascular drugs, the HIV drugs, all the way now through an array of cancer products. It's a company that's had, you know, a huge impact on society. And, you know, in the 90s, Merck was the it company.
Mm-hmm.
It was Fortune's most admired company 7 years in a row.
Yeah.
And that's because of an unparalleled track record of not only scientific innovation, but doing good for humanity. Programs like the Mectozan donation program, which, you know, have basically eliminated river blindness, were a huge part of what made the company a special place. And, you know, that is, you know, this industry at its best, where you can do good for shareholders while doing good for humanity.
Yeah.
And that was a core part of, I think, what I learned within Merck. And, you know, as I thought about going to biotech, certainly in a smaller organization, the impact of your actions and decisions, you know, at Merck, you had to influence a 72,000 person organization.
Yeah.
In a biotech organization, when I joined Generate, it was 30 people.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, each of those 30 employees had a huge impact on the success of the organization. Sometimes it was harder to see that impact in a big company, but I think the impact of the collective work of the 72,000 was enormous.
Sure. Yeah.
And you know, depending upon how you're measuring impact, you come up with different viewpoints.
Yeah. So, I mean, if listeners didn't know that you're CEO partner at Flagship and CEO at Generate, they might think they may think you're still an executive partner. Very, very passionate about the work you did there. Why did you leave? You know, I mean, it's like you could have stayed there until.
I bleed Merck teal. Like, you know, it's a company that is near and dear to my heart. It's a company with some of my best friends, some of my proudest professional moments. I was really just fortunate to uncover an amazing opportunity, what I think is a generational technology.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when I was at Merck, one of the things that I was fortunate enough to do was lead Merck's vaccine business. While I was leading Merck's vaccine business, we had an early partnership with Moderna in vaccines.
Mm-hmm.
During that time, I got to know Stefan Bonsell and Noubar Afeyan. So Stefan is the CEO of Moderna, and Noubar is the founder and CEO of Flagship Pioneer.
Mm-hmm.
And they, you know, we had had conversations over the years around, you know, if I were ever to leave Merck, what would I want to do? And, you know, over time, I became increasingly convinced that the future of the industry was going to lie at the intersection of science and technology. And, you know, I became, you know, increasingly frustrated in many respects that the industry wasn't having enough success at changing the underlying productivity curve, right? We've talked about it forever that in four decades in a row, industry-wide R&D productivity has been going down.
Mm-hmm.
And I think somewhat interrelatedly, but not entirely, that has led to bad pricing practices within the industry. And that those pricing practices have undermined patient access to medicines. And that's what, you know, I think creates some of the reputational conundrum that the industry finds itself within. And I became the belief on why science and technology would be this kind of potential answer. And it's simply, the fact that I think it's inarguable to look at the fact that, despite staring at biology in the eye for all of our existence as humanity, we only know a small fraction,
right,
of the majesty of biology.
Yeah.
And, with the advances in technology that we were seeing all around us, we were entering an age where the combination of brilliant human ingenuity and computation and technology was going to start to help us understand the language of biology in ways that the human mind alone couldn't understand it.
Mm-hmm.
And fortunately, the team at Flagship was working on a company called Generate Biomedicines. Generate was founded 5 years ago. When I first received this call, a little over three years ago, generative artificial intelligence was not part of my lexicon or the common lexicon.
Right. I mean, it's still a black box to most.
To most, yeah. And, but this team recognized that by applying a top-down approach to the language of proteins and using these sort of generative technologies, we would be able to understand that language in a way that would allow us to ultimately learn how to program novel protein-based therapeutics with desired attributes.
Mm-hmm.
And in the 20 years I've been part of the industry, I had never seen anything like the early data.
Yeah.
And if you think about how we discover protein therapeutics today, we immunize a human, a mouse, a llama. We cull through plasma. We find things that stick to interesting targets, and then we manipulate them.
Mm-hmm.
In a pure trial and error process.
Yeah.
We have no control over the antibodies our immune systems create. We then try and make them into drug-like entities. Think about the world where we say, give me a molecule with this code to treat this disease.
Yeah.
I mean, it sounds science fiction. And in many ways, we're not by any means there yet.
Sure.
But we're on a path toward that destination. And this technology was helping us start to understand that language of proteins in really profound ways. And some of the things that we were able to do were just beyond my wildest imagination. Some of the kind of interesting tidbits that I picked up as I was looking into the opportunity were the average protein has, we have 20 natural amino acids.
Mm-hmm.
The average protein may be 200 amino acids long. So if you think about the combinatorial possibilities of proteins, it's 20 to the 200th power. That's atoms in the universe cubed. The search space is extraordinary. And oftentimes we think about nature as being this all-powerful, all-knowing, being. The reality is that nature has only surveyed a small fraction of that search space.
Mm-hmm.
It's just too large.
Right.
And if you had a technology that would allow you to survey those oceans, you're going to find some really interesting things. And we're finding that on a daily basis, these technologies are helping us understand biology better. They're helping us come up with better answers to existing conditions, but also giving us new tools now to prosecute disease in pretty unique ways.